Hey everybody, welcome back. So first and foremost, you can see right here, had this little reversal pattern. We should probably just drill into this really quickly and just take a look at that. So you have this doji, and then what we're starting to see is that the next candle over, the new contracts, already starting to look a little bit weak there. Could be based upon some earnings. There's some things that came out in semis that are not great. We're gonna go through that this evening. But that doji, it's not really that crazy, is it? And then you take a look at the NQ as well. Take a look at the NASDAQ and you have that reversal below as well. Below the open, not really crazy about that, but it's really not the end of the world. But you take a look at RTY and you just see the straight up buying. Now, what was interesting about today is we're all aware that 8:30 tomorrow, you're going to see CPI. One of the core things is what names are affected by CPI, right? Well, so you have your regional banks. Well, they were up today. If you take a look at DPST, you just see that, just an absolute monster trade today. Who else is affected by interest rates? XBI, take a look at that, setting up to break back out. Everyone's aware of LABU being the 3X ETF there. So here we are once again, and what are we seeing? We're seeing rotation into what? We're seeing rotation into the interest rate sensitive names. We're gonna look at the indexes of, or sectors rather in a second, but take a look at some of these interest rate sensitive names. Affirm, up today. UPST, up today. Unable to get over that 55 though, ahead of earnings. CBNA, up today ahead of AN, which has earnings coming out. We have a bunch of earnings names to go over, but I think it would just take a moment here and take a look at the sectors, and this will really give you a real clear indication of what's going on here. Now, I do drop this in a lot in the pre-market, when we do the pre-market, the public one, and you should be able to have access to it at this point, but if you don't, let me know and I'll just drop it in again. I really don't mind sharing it. I have it in a watch list too, but just take a look and you see what's trading today. It's kind of like same superheated, but you're starting to see that, you know, the crypto names are up. You're just seeing the same ones again. Solars, they're just rocking and rolling. So when you start, that's AN. And what I should probably do just to end the confusion is just make this the SPY so that we can just look at the S&P with it. So it's going to throw me all off, isn't it? Let's just go back. We'll just make it AN for a second, leave it in there so that these they leave everything down, because they're only going to put them relative to that, and at least it leaves everything down for a moment. But just forget that AN's in there. It just makes it easier to see how these things are playing out. Pardon me. So what are we saying? We're seeing some of the sectors rally that are really interest rate sensitive, and that's something that we want to pay attention to. But I think that you start looking at this and going, okay, well, what exactly happened today? Well, semiconductors got a boost, right? So if we just start there, but I want to go through the Bitcoin as well. But let's start with semiconductors because this I thought was fascinating so people kind of get this. So what the heck happened today? I'm going to leave this in line form. Now, today at one point, we did exceptionally well on the long side with it. Also did a day trade where we would just bought SOSX and actually brought it down here. I'll just show you the little pattern so that if you ever see this little pattern yourself, you can just do it for yourself. It's really not very complicated. But what I was looking for was a turn. And I was looking for a turn because I didn't think people were going to take the risk going into CPI tomorrow. It's huge risk. The first of the year, CPI is always the most volatile historically, just so you know that. So this is the first one for January, meaning January CPI is always the most volatile. Contracts reset, the seasonality's gone, you're starting from square one, you don't know what you're getting. Life's like a box of chocolates. But you see how you're just kind of grinding up here in the RSI, see how this is just kind of going sideways. So I was just looking for indications, and we did have the definition of froth today, didn't we? I mean, if you've been trading for a while, froth is when the market just gets really excessive. And we saw that today, we're gonna talk about it, and how you could actually take advantage of it, and how it was easy. If you knew what to look for, how it was easy to determine which one was actually going to break out and go higher and why it was ARM. It was actually a no-brainer and it had nothing to do with the company itself, but just a technical thing. And we're going to discuss it. So we got involved here at the end of the day. Some people are going to hold, some people are just going to close them, and that's fine. It is what it is. There's nothing technical about this, but you did get to a point where you just got a little too frothy and I just thought it was a real simple trade. So we did it. And I'm glad that we did, but what's going on here? Well, let's just start here. So you start with the socks and we overlay the socks, right? And let's get rid of the pre and the post. And this is going to be really important for people to get because this is going to be very telling and you're going to be able to do this yourself. So if you look at the SOX and the SOX is ripping, and then we overlay names like NVIDIA, SMCI, AMD, right? And if people say SMCI is not a semiconductor, you know where I'm going with this. So if we overlay these names and then we put ARM in here as well, and we're just looking for the big movers, and then what we'll do is we'll just drop this right into a line. Well, why is ARM there? But let's just drop this to a one, and then we're going to drop this down to a nine. And let me just get to that real quickly. Here we are on the 12th. Perfect. 12th already. Jeez. So you can kind of see what's happening here, right? And the ARM is the big winner out of all of them. Okay. Why is that, and why was this happening here? Well, there's first and foremost, there were very distinct patterns that were happening on Friday. So if we start there, you'll be able to see this really clearly. So go back to candles, drop in on a daily, and you're seeing this at the high close on Friday. So that means that your weekly is going to close there, right? So your weekly is closing at an all-time high. Always look Friday at your weeklies and see how they're closing. That'll tell you what has the most opportunity to jump off the open. So then we saw that, and then what we did here was NVIDIA. We saw that closing at all-time high on Friday, and then we saw SMCI closing at an all-time high on Friday. Index sector stock, right? That's how I trade. It's top-down. Index sector stock. So that's what made us able to do this. This is just a simple way of seeing what we're doing here, some of the trades. But really what I want you to focus on, I'm just going to show the observations or the live alerts because it's simpler for me to do it this way, time-saving. This is the secondary long-term ad we had in ARM where we made over $70. We bought a secondary position and we got out of, it was over 100%. So we scaled out when it was like at 150, something like that today. And we already had the other position that we're in at $60 and we scaled out of about half of that already. So we're already pulling that money out. I mean, you have a double in 3 months on one quarter of earnings. You kind of have to think about it. Very simple trades, but here, see this right here, 349. So what I'm doing is I'm buying stock and calls at the end of the day for over the weekend. How were we able to do that? And there's the SOX trade there as well. How was I able to do that? Index sector stock. It's real simple, right? You see the index close the way that it did, whether you're going to look at the NASDAQ or what you're going to look at, you're closing at all-time highs. You know what your leading names are. Before you know what your leading names are, you want to look at the leading sector, SOX, index, sector, stock. I'm saying it again and again so that you get it, right? That's why you wanted to do this. Now, some people would say, well, why wouldn't you want to do MSTR? And you absolutely could have done that as well. And there are people in the room that did, and they did exceptionally well with that. The issue is you're dealing with the underlying asset. The underlying asset did not bid up. So you had all morning to redo these trades. If you look at how block acted at the end of the day or how Bitcoin pulled back on Friday, there was a little nuance there. That nuance led me to do the SOX trades, which actually played out really well. On top of that, I came in with ARM options and also came in with ARM stock, which we've been in for some time. But really important here to get that distinction. So I want to point something out to you before we start. And I want to show you this live trade. And I want to talk about what's happening out there and what we need to be aware of. But I want you to get this concept because this is a really important concept. It's not technical. It is just, it's just a fact. So every morning we live trade and I'm going to show it to you, but, and everybody knows this pattern too. We talked about it. Actually, we were actually laughing, but I've actually shown you guys this pattern probably 100 times in these videos, guys. Up, down, 1, 2, 3, up, right? I mean, this is textbook stuff. Rising 3, falling 3. Look up this pattern. Rising 3, falling 3. You can actually look them up in Bukowski's book. I have that book sitting right here. Encyclopedia of Candlestick Charts. Yep, Encyclopedia of Candlestick Charts. He actually goes through that in great detail. I like Neeson's book a little bit better, but I do like what he does there. Anyway, what we see before this even opens, so I use different brokers. I just don't use one broker. If you've been watching these videos, I compartmentalize my trades. And with this particular trade, I had a lot on in a different account that I do for overnight holds. It works. My brain works better by compartmentalizing my trades. I don't want my swings with day trades, vice versa. All right. So one of my brokers just sends this text or message alert, uptick rule in effect on ARM, and they're clawing stock back. Hits boom immediately. And they're a pretty good firm. So as soon as I saw that, I'm like, oh, this has a problem. So we knew right off the rip that if they're going to claw back stock and they're going to put in the uptick rule and they're going to enforce the uptick rule, which gets a whole other litany of issues on who can short this, how you're going to short this. And it's basically telling you there's no stock out there. Or if you do, it's going to be hard to borrow. So when you know that that's what's happening here, that's why when you look at something like ARM, there was no chance that it was not going to outperform the others. It has nothing to do with technology. It has nothing to do with anything else. Nothing. Okay. It had everything to do with them saying this hard to borrow. Yeah. It's really, really hard to borrow now. And we want our stock back. Now that could just be the institutions saying, by the way, or it could be Moshi-san with SoftBank basically saying, you know what? Move that from margin to cash and getting rid of all the shorts, drive the stock up before they come in and probably sell their position. or liquidate their position. I think sometime mid-March they're allowed to sell. And of course, they're going to liquidate some of it. I mean, it'd be stupid not to. But that's why you outperformed today. It has nothing to do with the company in and of itself. Here, take a look. Watch this video.
Arms get ready to push again. I added some ARM back Friday afternoon. I have a ton of calls on ARM out to the 16th, the 120s, the 130s, 125s. What's this little thing that's lit up here? Oh, you can't even short it. They're putting restrictions on ARM today, guys. They're going to start pulling it from people. Just FYI, ARM's going to move. Watch this, guys. You can't short it. They're going to start calling it back on people. Yeah, this is going to be nasty. I have the 120s. I have the 125s. I have stock. I'm not going to do anything with the stock, but I'm probably going to close some of these, maybe. ARM, I closed some of those calls. I'm still on some others. All right, so we're going to close some more of this ARM. This is the one that can push the most. This is the one that I just got a message for early this morning where they're looking for stock and they're going to start calling the short away from people. That's a problem. So the video catch again, SMCI just looks like a beast, but this is the one that technically ARM, like they can't do anything about. They're stuck. The one I'd really be focused on out of all of them is ARM, because I think that that can get really, really goofy. Like really goofy. If they're going to call stock away from people, that's going to be a monster. Like you get that phone call in the morning, we're calling your stock. So if you're doing this little trade, you're just going to scale into this and pull stuff out because you don't know when it's going to end. You're just day trading it. That's all I'm doing is just pulling stuff out as it's doing that, because I don't know when the party ends and it will end. You just don't know when. So what they're doing, if I got that message, what they're doing is they're looking for stock, right? They're calling stock away from people. That could mean that whoever owns the stock just put it to like a cash account. They no longer have the borrow. So it can just get a little goofy here. And that's why this one's outperforming. It's got nothing to do with it being the better company or anything like that. It's just a very technical move. That's why I'm hyper-focused on it right now. And people are trying to figure out why this one's outperforming versus SMCI and NVIDIA. And you learned something today. Trimmed it. Now, when I say I'm trimming it, I'm trimming the ad that I put on here. I'm not trimming the long term. I didn't trim any of those options. I'm just trimming this because I don't know when this party ends. And it will end. And I already have a ton of it. We might call an ARM nasty. You're not allowed to short it. If you can't short it, they're going to call the stock away. They're going to call the stock away. Like picture being short the stock and then you get a phone call this morning when the market's about to open. And that's what they do. Oh, by the way, you know, you're short. Yeah, we're going to have to call that back. And then you have to close. You don't have a choice. I'm printing under 27. I'll close more. That was fun. 100% out of that scalp. Thank you very much. On to the next one. Close the 125 calls I had on ARM. And I got some 120s. Might hold those. Out of all my calls on ARM, still on the stock.
Now, I hope you found that live trade helpful. There's a bunch of P&L stuff I could go over. But I really want to hammer a couple points home today. So whenever anybody joins the community, I have conversations. And I always say this thing about culling your feed. And what do I mean when I say cull your feed? What I'm trying to get people to refer to or understand is watch who they listen to. Even me, if you find out that you're talking to me and that I'm interfering with your trading, you shouldn't be talking to me. If you find out that this information is stopping you from the way that you want to trade, then you need to stop, right? No matter who it is. I don't care if it's on, you know, Twitter. I don't care if it's on YouTube, Instagram, whoever it is, it doesn't matter. You just need to cut it out, right? And not deal with it. And I want to be really clear about this, because what I'm seeing is a lot of people that are out there saying things like, this is too high. This can't go higher. All right. People were saying that here, including myself, right? Had feelings like, well, this is getting kind of goofy. And then I saw this move on Friday and I'm like, if you're going to take over this previous close, there's an issue here. We're going to want to be involved, right? So that kind of gave me a heads up there. I didn't know this was coming. I had no clue that this was coming, right? No one has a clue when this is coming, because if you knew when this was coming, you would just get ahead of it. Anybody would. So it's not like investment banks are going to telegraph it. What it boils down to is understanding the knowledge and going from there. The reason I'm telling you to cull your feed is because for the longest time, I've been watching people talk about NVIDIA and telling you that NVIDIA can't possibly go higher, it can't possibly go any higher. Now, I can show you why it could, and I can show you why it could implode. I can give you two sides of it. But the bottom line is the same people that were saying that here now have lost what? What did it add? $800 billion in value? I think it's something like $800 billion. It was $800 billion here. And now we're at what? 1.6 or 1.5 trillion, something like that. Okay. So how much of that did you capture? Or did you listen to some guy that told you that the stock was too high? All right. You need to learn to trade what's actually going on and stop trying to be the person that's predicting the top. Why do you want to be the person that's predicting the top instead of just making money and following what the trend's doing and making money following the trade? It doesn't make any sense, guys. It doesn't. And I'm going to be honest, you're never going to catch it. Even when you think you caught it, you didn't catch it. Right. And you have to understand that. And I'm guilty of it too sometimes. Even here, I was short. Yes, people in the room, I shorted here. I did exceptionally well with the trade. I was feeling really good about myself. We had a double on some puts. What happened by the end of the day? And I knew. And if you go back to this video, go look at February 6th's video or February 7th's video, you will see me talk about this pattern and say you need to get involved with this. And people told me, you're crazy, you shouldn't be talking like that. It's up 100 points because I know what this pattern does, right? You're basically looking at a dragonfly at the top of a chart, and wicks are what? Price rejection. You need to trade what's actually happening, not what you want to have happen because you missed it, right? So now you have FOMO. You know, people don't understand how much like their limiting beliefs affect their trading. You need to check yourself with this stuff. I'm hammering this point home because I don't think people fully understand how long this can go on for and how heavy this can get up and down. And so you want to be aware of that. Okay, now tomorrow you're going to have CPI. CPI is going to be absolutely huge. It is going to affect IWM the most. There's no question about that. You can see that already. That means TZA on the bear is in play. TNA on the bull is in play. Both 3X ETFs. What else will move? Anything that is tied to CPI, interest rates will move. So you'll see things like LABU. They're already getting ahead of it. Now, you have people on both sides of this. That's from the newsletter. If you don't get the free newsletter, link in description, I'll also post it. But you need to understand something about this, right? People are like, oh, the move's over. Is it? Because it looks to me like we just consolidated right around the breakout bar. That's all we've really done there. You do the simplest of indicators, and now we're back over the 12 and the 22. All right, so is this over, or did it just consolidate, and now it's pushing and getting setting up to go higher, right? So we just have to look at what's going on, and this is one of the easiest ways to do it is call your feed and set up a process. You know, and I can't stress that enough. If someone you're watching is calling the top of the market or calling the bottom of the market, and they're not hedging it and telling you why they feel that way or what to look for, run away screaming because they have no idea what they're doing because no one has any clue what's going to happen. All we have are probabilities, and we associate that probability and then we put a trade on. That's it. And that's what you're supposed to be doing. But if you take a look at XBI here, it looks pretty good, right? KRE, this was interesting because you were unable to really lift even though you're at the bottom. But if you take a look at XLF, well, that's hitting highs. So now you're seeing the Goldmans of the world, right? They're grinding higher. They're coming out of this big base, aren't they? Clear all that off. Let's just make this the base case, right? Take a look at this. And please watch Saturday's video. I get very heavily into why you're seeing the consumer discretionaries running the way that they are. But take a look at that. So that's kind of an interesting time for that to happen, isn't it? Right before CPI. It's always like somebody knows, right? I guess we'll find out tomorrow morning. JP Morgan, how's that look? And then you realize that you're at the second highest close that it's ever had. Right, so maybe we're starting to see a rotation. Now, a good thing that we could do here is just maybe we don't need all 40 sectors, but maybe we could take a second and just drill into either just 20 sectors and see how that's going. And let's just drop. We'll make this SPY again. And then what we'll do is we'll just make this a line. And then we'll just sit there and go, okay, let's just make this go out to one. XBI, well, what's lifting? XBI is lifting. All right, so if you were just to go out there and just look at the major sectors, and I just dropped it to 20 major ones, right? And you start going out there and go, okay, well, what's leading? Okay, XBI, gold's dropping, utilities are coming up, energy's coming up, all right? And look what's down here, tech, tech, tech. All right, so what are they doing? They're selling tech. They're buying defensive and they're buying the interest rate trade. I'm going to say that one more time so you get it. They're selling tech, right? Here's the Qs. Cloud is lower than the Qs. XLK, which is Apple and Microsoft. 45% of XLK is Apple and Microsoft. 22, 23% apiece. IGV, think Dell, IBM, okay? Those names. SOX, okay? These are all coming down. What's going up? The Utes, two Utes, and biotech, right? Okay, so if you were to say on the day, when you started today and you were going to say that, by the way, consumer staples are going to outperform the stocks, okay, based upon how the day started, this is what's happening. So it's very important for you to just take a snapshot, look at these, overlay it with your own trading and go, does it make sense how I'm positioned for tomorrow? The people that are positioned correctly, frankly, are the people that are long biotech if they think that CPI is going to be weaker than expected. And again, no matter what happens with CPI, it will be volatile tomorrow. That much we know. So I hope you find that helpful in using that. I hope you took something from how I explained how to trade that today and how we traded ARM. That's the whole purpose of me doing these videos. So I always appreciate your comments. They really are extremely helpful. I do want to talk about Bitcoin here because I think this is powerful what's going on here. So you pulled back and now you're forming that cup and you're breaking out. You're above that. I can say anything I want, but this is what's happening. Now, what's really interesting is this is up 3%, and this is why I think there's something to it. Now, I don't know if there's something to Coin, and Coin has earnings this week. Like, I don't know if that's the one I would do because I don't know enough about the earnings and how that's going to go. But when you're in a situation where Bitcoin is up like 3.5% right now, and then you're in a situation where you're looking at the underlying securities such as MSTR, right? And that's up 11%, 12% on the day. And you're looking at Mara, and that's up where it is 14% on the day. Look at how that's closing right now, right? And you start seeing these trades. Well, that's extremely powerful stuff. Extremely powerful stuff. And the reason why is that so powerful? Well, that's powerful because you're moving almost 2 or 3x at least what the underlying security is. See, if you remember what happened before, and pay attention to this lesson because this is a great way of you understanding when the party's about to end. And everybody's always trying to figure out when the party's going to end. So I'm going to show you a way to do it. So you see where Mara is right here? See how Mara is going higher on the daily? We could probably do this on a 4 hour or on a hourly, right? So let's do it on the 4 hour because I think that'll just be glaringly obvious. All right, so here's the peak, right? And then what happens? Well, Bitcoin's still going higher and Mara's starting to come down, okay? But if you look at the beginning, when Bitcoin starts going higher, what's happening, okay? What's happening? As Bitcoin's going higher, we're outperforming, right? When the performance changes and Bitcoin's going higher, but Mara and MSTR are not going higher, then it's usually time to get out of the, you know, the sympathy plays, which really are Mara and MicroStrategies. Doesn't mean that Bitcoin can't go higher, but understand where I'm going with this. What you're trying to do is, you know, maximize the trade, right? And really what you're doing is you're just trading based upon sympathy. That's all. That's the only reason Mara went up. So, you know, I mean, if you overlook this and you said, well, Bitcoin's here and it was here when Mara was where, right? Mara was higher, right? So you go back and take a look at it. Mara was here. Now look where it is. And now you look at Bitcoin. Well, why isn't it there? Because it's one, it's all perception. Two, it's just a trading vehicle for it. And that's how you have to look at it. The most important takeaway from this is when you see Mara start slowing down and not even able to hold the same percentage as the underlying asset, it's probably a good idea to get out of the way. Now, a couple developments over the evening. We have Icahn, who is now taking a 10% stake. And you'll probably see this actually trade up now. He's going to take a 10% stake in JetBlue, which is fascinating. And I'm wondering if he's going to come in and renegotiate this whole deal. I think he might renegotiate the whole save JetBlue deal, figure out how to put the whole thing together and come in and save both companies. That's where I think he's going with this. I could be wrong, but to me, I don't know why this one's not popping up. There it goes. I would not bet against him. And I am long IEP, just FYI. And I think that this will be definitely one on the radar tomorrow that people are certainly going to want to watch and watch how this plays out. You can see the move immediately when he got involved with it. And you can go, kind of go from there, make your own decisions. They will be extremely volatile tomorrow. And there's a couple things here that we should just talk about. And that the quarter to me was good. You're playing, you're playing a little bit musical chairs with the CFOs, new CFO. That never really goes over well, no matter what the issue. So you're going to kind of want to watch that. I'd be very careful of the software names. Net crushed, and all we did was just drop straight down, right? So we're going to want to be aware of that. Annette, you're kind of seeing something very similar here, where I don't think the quarter was that bad. I thought they guided decently. I thought it was really good. The winner of the evening is definitely going to be ZI. The expectations, when you have blowups like this, you get to the point where the blowups are so bad, and the guidance is so bad, and then it just finally hits a point where people are like, ah, you know what? It's really not that bad. And they get involved. We saw that with ENPH the other day, and we saw that with that entire sector, didn't we? So that's something that I would look at as well. But for tomorrow, just understand when you're looking at names like NVIDIA, and you're looking at names like SMCI, and I'm not saying that this is the high. I'm not saying that it isn't the high. My whole purpose of this is to just be blunt and say, nobody really knows. So you're better off having processes to trade in these kinds of environments. Pull out as much as you can, and then just get the heck out of the way. That's it.